Hello for Friday, August 26th. This is the Dow dropping 170 points after a good open, but you see we left a kind of a bearish engulfing right here. We said yesterday that we run into the 20-day, and of course we need to close above that and hopefully above this top line as well. Then we could shoot right up to the 50-day, but we weren't able to do it, and look at this, we had higher volume. Now, depending on how the market perceives whatever Ben Bernanke says tomorrow, maybe this engulfing candle means nothing and we'll move back up. But if we do drop below the low from both Thursday and Wednesday, though, we could, of course, retrace down this whole distance down here. If we look at the futures chart of the Dow, it was an interesting day. And remember, we showed this chart yesterday. We also posted it before the close, or just at the close yesterday, and then we posted it at midnight because it was very interesting. Sometimes these do line up this way, and they don't always fulfill the targets, and this one didn't look at first like it would. But you can see we had, from this dip, remember this was the midnight the day before, we had dipped down and we posted the chart that this would be a buy area at support. It worked out well. It ran up to here, came back down to a retracement area, and then we just did a measured move. So if it goes back up, if it fulfilled the measured move, it would go up. These arrows are the same, they're just one's copied to the other. That also happened to be the 161.8 Fibonacci projection level from the high of the last one, and it did both of those on Thursday. During the quick run up in the morning, it ran right up to it, which also happened to be our one. So obviously when it does that kind of thing, people on a gap up because of Bank of America, it's a good chance to sell. It's run up a lot in the last couple days, and there's questions about what's going to happen with the talk from Ben, and so they took profits, and that's a good thing to do when you hit targets like this measured move. That's why it's called a measured move, and so they took profits, and then of course short sellers come in, so it came down. But look what it did. The good thing is it's come down to this trend line, and this trend line has two touches beyond this point going up to the left hand side, and it's come down. So if it can hold in this area, we'll check on the overnight. If it does break there, it also may have support this lower line as well, so that's one thing to watch. Okay, on the Russell, we'll look at that as well, and this one's just the weekly, which won't show you much, just that we're still in that area, but we have a futures on this one as well. And you can see we're now, this lower trend line avoids the candle lower level here coming down, and just hits on the next candle up, and you can see that the moment we're right at that level. If this breaks, then we look back to the same level it was at 670, where it found support before. If that doesn't work out, then it could easily just drop down to the 6, which was the before the 61.8 at 659, or on top of this trend line as well, the blue one that's coming down. Those are the two areas to watch if we break below 670.50. But if you look at this longer term back in the cash chart again, here you can see that trend line coming down, and we're still on top of that. So that's the bullish side of things still being on top. And the SPX, you can see it's still on the weekly chart, so it's lost some of its gains, but it's still above the 50%, and it's underneath the 38.2% and underneath the trend line. But as you know, when we get up to that trend line, that's a popular, whenever you break a trend line, when you go back to it from underside, that's a popular place for people to put in shorts. And do we have an ES? We do indeed have the S&P. It also made its measured move. As you can see, these two pink lines are the same, and it ran up. Now its measured move didn't take it to the 161.8, but to the 127.2, and you can see we ran above that as well. And what we have highlighted here is the resistance area. You can see over here at the left hand side of the chart, in the past that was kind of support area from this whole area here, so anywhere in there was going to be resistance. It ran over the 127.2, so just like the Dow, that's a place that people took profits on measured moves like this. We're not the only ones to see it, for sure. And so that's then created the sell-off. But you'll note that we are above the descending trend line, so a test from on top is a good thing. If we break below that, then look for 1147, or maybe a little bit below where it broke to before. But this is where we had the line, and it's a little more solid support. But we could go as low as it went before, but look to 1140, 1141. We'd want to see that support if we're going to continue this rebound as an uptrend. By the way, we're showing a lot of the futures charts. Our global futures will do a webinar for us probably after, we'll wait until after the Labor Day weekend, but probably I think it would be good to have it like maybe half hour after the market closed. Let us know what would be a good time, but we can cover all the platforms and anything of interest for you. Okay, now let's take a look at, oh, also by the way, here is NASDAQ 100, and it did drop back below this trend line, and you can see the little blip there. Now it's basically at it, so this could bounce back up as well, but this didn't rally as much as the other markets did. And I don't think that was to do with Apple, but we will show you Apple because we had posted this as well, because it had closed. Remember when that sold off in the aftermarket on Wednesday with the announcement of Jobs leaving, not leaving company, just stepping down as CEO. It sold off quite a bit, but then it came right back up. And once it got over this trend line, then it could become a buy again, obviously. So it did, and it was a good buy, and it rallied back up. Not quite the breakout from this, but these are areas to watch now. And this triangle is diminishing in size, so it's going to break one way or the other. So you can trade it either way, or you can always short failure from breakout and buy at support. So you have four possibilities of trading there. Gold had a little bit of a boost back up after its downfall. You know, it had come down, and then once it got back over this 20-day, so there was some added buying of it as well, but it came down a little bit lower. Now, we'll see what happens over the next week or so, if it can keep on going up, or if we break back under the 20-day, there's going to be additional selling in shorts. Interactive Brokers put out a note that there may be in some markets, in some metals, maybe some additional margin requirements, and we don't know if that's going to affect gold or whether that's going to be the case for gold or not. But anyway, a break below that again could bring it down to that 1666, which is the 50-day moving average. But this also became a buy, and we posted this chart as well at the point where it had gone down to the was very close to the 78.6 retracement. We posted that this would be, it's obvious, it's an important level, it's a buy point. It started to bounce there, and then it came back down and did test it. And it was a pretty good trade, because from that 165.80, it ran up above about 172, so that was okay. And you'll note, we did say in that post as well, you can also watch the RSI, because it had just been at 30 or just a little bit above, and you can see it ran up to 43. So when those things happen, if you're interested in trading, those are the times to buy. You don't wait till it moves up 6-7 points and then think, well, now it's going in our favor, because maybe then they'll smack it down again. On turnarounds like this, you want to get as close to support. It's like buying breakouts. You want to buy as close as you can, because then your stop can go under, because then you know it could come down to this little gap down here a little bit lower. So if you're wrong, you want to get out quick, but if you're trading on hitting support levels, you want to get in as fast as you can as well. Okay, then we have got GDX. There was a bounce up, as you can see. It added a buck. It's still on the mechanical trade, still is just short, but some of that profit is moved up. And SLV, the same thing, that is still on the short side. All right, so let's get to additions to the watch list. Insofar as trading of the day, there are a couple things that gapped up and never really developed much, and there's a couple that triggered and they didn't do a whole lot either with this market reversal. It looked like it opened up the day pretty interesting, but by the end of the day, the ones that gapped up, obviously, like Bank of America, a big gap up here, so we knew that this would not be a normal trade, but it's just a gap up. We can now watch this for a pullback. If it pulls back to the support area here, that 722, that could be a buy as well, if that holds that support. We'll mark this as gap up, but pay attention to it because this could be a good trade. Look at this huge volume in there. We did post it as a 15-minute gap rule, and that worked out. If you went on the short side, as you know, you after the 15-minute range is established, you can buy on a break to the top, or you can short sell on a sell to the bottom, depending on how you like to trade. And in this case, it broke a little earlier where we have the arrow, but down here it broke several times, and you can see it never really got much up above it. So, and then you might want to watch the RSI, and we like to watch the 9-period EMA as well. But you can see the RSI at that point also dropped below 70, and we posted it right here at 738. We noticed that the RSI had gone under 30, so we posted the chart and said, we may be hitting a bounce here because we're RSI's at 30, and there was a start of a little candle here. And sure enough, that turned out to be the low of the day, so it was a very good trade, and just shows that this doesn't work every time. But if you pay attention, when you have gap ups or gap downs, if you use it, sometimes even if it's just a day trade, in this case it was, it worked out well. Okay, so here's some additions for us for Friday. We've got ABV, and this is an all-time high. It's trying to go back up. Beverages and beer and so forth. And the 34.58 was a past high. You can zero in, and you can look that they've got a little pennant going on here. Volume wasn't great on the little consolidation, which is good. So this has possibilities that this one may be moving higher. Next up, I'm waiting for a mouse on my other screen. Okay, here we go. Back. How about AONE? AONE back over its 50-day at 475. It moved over it and then it pulled back. So maybe better if it just doesn't try immediately but consolidates a day or two. But then if it goes back over at 475 or the high of the day, which is 481. First, with this market, we're just trying to, get what we can. So the first area would be at the top Bollinger Band here, perhaps up at the second line we have there. And be happy with those until we can establish a firm trend up. But we like the increase in volume for the day. And so we think that this could be a trade as well. Likewise, we've got Chiquita Brands. This is familiar setup. It closed on Wednesday back over the 20-day, and it closed again basically right at it. The sell-off was on lower volume than the move back up, so if this can get over 1034, then we have a move up to the next line to start things off, a breakout over there, maybe to the 50-day or maybe to the top Bollinger Band. FOSL, we don't know what we can say. We know it needs better volume, of course. We like to see it. So on the consolidation day, it was lower volume. So then we want to see a run rate like the 2 days before. But it consolidates a few more days, might be better, because it might have run out of energy moving up from the 72 up to 90. So consolidation first. And if you like this the price range stock and you like the movement of it, it can move a lot of points. So consolidation, it did stay over the 200-day. So we're just saying back over 93 or the 94.70 are possibilities. See, note where the 20-day is and note where the 50-day moving average is as well. Otherwise, you'll be a lazy boy. And this one looks like continuation over this 8.29. The day before on Wednesday, it closed at the 20-day. It moved over it, opened at it, went underneath it, and then came up, and it moved up nicely, 5-6%. So it may need a rest as well, but increased volume, and that is encouraging. And note where the 50-day is on that. NTSP is another one. Over $6.02 would put it into the gap. Had a little consolidation day. Again, it also is over the 20-day, which is encouraging. And lastly, we have VHC over its 20-day at 21.60 or 22.50. That was the high of the day. You can see a target here that would be probably about the 25.30. That would be the 50-day. But this also had good increased volume on it. That's a good thing. So we'll see if that can continue. A lot of this depends on what the market does for the Friday. It's going to be the end of the month next month as well. So next week. So that means maybe we'll get some window dressing next week, even regardless of what happens on Friday. So it's a weekend. That means we'll have a newsletter coming out. It's free. Just sign up on the homepage there. Put your address in. We'll get that out to you. So I hope you have a super summer weekend, the last weekend before the holiday weekend. And we'll send out tweets throughout the day. Pay attention, because if you're futures trading, you can find some of those setups. They don't happen every day, but when they do, they can work out really well. So have a good day trading. Thanks for watching, and see you on Friday. Bye.